What's going on, everybody? Gunner here, and today I got, well, it's not really new, it's just a hybrid pattern, and what we're going to do is we're going to take a trout nugget, the kind of the baitfish trout nuggets and the sculpin trout nuggets, so you got a shank and a hook up front, and we're going to combine it with a jerk junior so that you get a really kind of short, fat, bulky, sculpted Steve Farrar blend silhouette, kind of tall pattern. With the dubbing head, you get a nice tall pattern. That way you can imitate, you know, kind of like sunfish. This is a bluegill pattern right here. You can do crappie, you know, you can do all of your kind of bluegill, little sunfishy variations, as well as like crappie and stuff like that. So, thought it was a really sweet design that I'm doing for kind of like a custom order. And you get that nice tall vertical stacked silhouette, get a good jerk action on it. We're gonna tie it on a 1/0 Attitude Extra from Partridge, so you got some decent hook mass so that you can kind of carry that fly off, and that's what we're gonna tie. So I got just about everything prepped so that we can kind of knock this thing out of the park. So first thing I'm going to do, I'm gonna come in with a 20 millimeter kind of fish spine. And you can tie it on, I guess you can do whatever size you want. I'm going to have to change threads here. We're just going to tie this to something else. But it's a 20 millimeter fish spine. You can use a 20 millimeter articulated shank, but this kind of has a smaller hoop in the back, which kind of keeps your rabbit zonker coming off the tail at a more natural angle, which I kind of like. And one of the reasons why I like to do the extension instead of doing like a really long rabbit tail is it fouls less, so it gives me something to kind of build my tail section onto, right? The other thing is it's gonna allow me to kind of sculpt that belly backwards so I can carry my silhouette farther back and I have more control over how those SF fibers kind of lay, instead of trying to get those going rearward off of a single hook up front. I now kind of have something to stack them on and control that silhouette. So one of the important things about this rabbit zonker is I have it tapered. I cut the tip into a V, and I'll show you that in a second once I got this guy tied down. And that V is going to help reduce the stiffness of that rabbit wing as you go towards the tip, so it's going to be able to deflect more. It's going to wiggle more. And that water that's kind of saturated within that material is going to be able to accelerate out, and you're going to get that nice kind of tail whip from a swimming baitfish tail. And I just took some Zappa Gap there, wrapped it on top of our current thread wraps, and then I'm going to cut this zonker strip past the eye so that I can trap down some of these fibers and get a little bit of a forward lean into that zonker strip. So you can see here, I got that nice kind of V taper going on so that I have reduction of kind of stiffness. I can get water acceleration so that that tip, it kind of has like a whiplash to it, you know what I mean? I don't want the whole tail to just kind of whip. I want a little tail flick. I want the tail flick. You know what I'm talking about? So, we got our zonker wing tied down, and the length of that, if you look at it from when the taper starts, boom, it's basically one shank length. So if you ignore the taper, it's one shank length back. That's how long the wing is. And I'm coming in with Steve Farrar blend, which is a nice S-crinkle synthetic fiber. And what I did is I pulled it out at full length and then I cut it into quarters. So I'm going to do a quarter of Steve Farrar blend per stack. And the technique to tie this in, I believe, is called V-style. And so what I did, because I'm getting ahead of myself, because I'm trying to tie fast, I'll pin this down just because this one's a little bit more technical, being right on that shank bump, and then I'll walk you through it. So I'm taking these fibers, just doing straight yellow, put a small taper into it. I'm going to hold this at the midpoint, put this across the shank at about a 45 degree angle, which is going to be hard to show you guys, and then I'm going to loop that twice. So if you can see, it's at this 45 degree angle kind of going up. My hand's in the way. So I got half the fibers towards the camera and half the fibers towards me, and then you just draw those fibers back without catching any rabbit and pin those back on the shank. And then you end up with a V splitting your hook shank on either side, hence the V style. And then I find it easiest if you tie down your rabbit wing before you do that last belly stack. So I'm just going to pull that taut so it's nice and tight to the shank. Two wraps, pull it down, release that, get some securing wraps on that, and then we'll half hitch and cut off our excess. And you can see how much kind of leather I have left over, right? Got like a millimeter of leather there, and it helps just build a little steep angle, trapping down some of that zonker fiber. Makes for a little bit cleaner kind of silhouette, and it helps the front hook bleed into the back hook a little bit better. Get these guys trapped down, and then we're just going to whip finish, and we'll get this guy articulated. So I think one of the biggest issues people have with the kind of SF is over trimming. There's always a tendency to over trim it, right? And you want a nice sculpted 3D kind of belly to it. So I like to kind of rough these out, right? Rough these out and get a nice kind of bulbous shape to it so that they're all kind of random. And then I just kind of like cut my 45s so that I get a belly immediately just by cutting 45s. So I came in, it was all rough, and then I cut at a 45 and a 45, if that makes sense. That way you just get a very rough shape, and then you can just kind of contour your center line to match a teardrop. Come back, and then the rest is just eyeball work, you know? It's just, the more you do it, the more you're comfortable with it, the more easier it becomes. And that's all you're looking for, you know? You don't want to do any more than that. You can always come back and do it later. We'll do a little trimming once we get it articulated to blend the two bellies together. But that's about all I'm looking for. Then I'm going to come in with a 1/0 Attitude Extra, which is a Partridge hook. Really, it's like a quadruple thick wire hook. It's got a great amount of mass to it for doing single hook jerk flies. Going to help propel that fly through the water when you kind of give it slack, when you in between strips, in between jerk strips, in between however you choose to animate it. And most importantly, it's going to keel the fly, because I want a nice tall fly to imitate sunfish, right? Which are kind of like, they're super tall, they're super thin, so they can turn on a dime. And when you try to imitate that in larger sizes, a lot of times they have a tendency to lay on their side. Coming in now with a nylon coated stainless steel wire, and we're just going to pin that to the top, create a nice vertical loop, and we're going to keep that loop about the width of a hook eye. Sweet. Try this again. So I'm not doing any spacing beads, right? I just want this kind of right tight to the shank. The whole point of it is it's not really designed to articulate per se. There's going to be enough room in this loop that it can articulate, but I want the loop kind of small enough that it doesn't have the complete range of motion that it would normally have. That way it reduces fouling. And you want to bring that loop down so that it's in line with the hook shank, which is going to give you kind of the best swimming action. And that's the swimming action, is just so any push of water kind of hits it in a streamlined motion so that your waves come back, they animate that tail evenly so that you're not getting more waves on one side than the other, or top and bottom. You just want a nice, even, perfectly kind of in line with the fish spine. Is kind of like a game changer theory, right? So we're going to come in and we're going to get our rabbit zonkered right on top here. And I like to leave just enough skin to kind of bridge that gap. You can see that. I'm going to actually thin out the zonker a little bit. I got pretty thick leather back there. Just enough to cover that kind of connection. Wet our fingers, move our hair back. And then we're going to get two nice wraps, two clean wraps over that hair. And then I'm going to hit my thread with some Zap-A-Gap and run that over top of that to protect all that from teeth and from breaking out. And I'm going to clip this to length to get it out of my way. And again, I'm going to clip it basically to the hook eye so that when I trap down that zonker at the end, I have excess kind of winging fibers that I'm trapping down so I can get a steep forward kind of head and shoulder angle to it. A few wraps in front, back over top so that can't loosen up. Then we're going to come in immediately with some more Steve Farrar blend. Now the front stacks, you can always do them slightly denser. I've never counted how many fibers, I've always eyeballed it for this stuff. But if I had to guess, there's probably 15 fibers on the back. And if you go to the front, you know, probably 20. It's rather quite sparse because you're doing multiple stacks. The back has 3 stacks, the front's going to have 4 stacks. And what you don't want to do is you really don't want to overdo it. You just want enough that you can shape it, sculpt it, because they do trap water. You know, these S-crinkle fibers, they got thin air pockets in between each section, enough so to trap water. The top of your wire is always sharp. Watch out for that. I should know better. But I want to keep, I don't want to trap so much water that those fibers kind of get heavy and slow that fly down, because I want a nice clean kind of jerk to it. So it's not going to jerk as much as a Jerk Junior or a Super Jerk or anything like that, because it's got a lot more water drag than either of those designs have. But it is going to help keel it, and it's going to pin it off to the side so that you get a nice clean kind of profile show to whatever predator you're targeting. I'm coming in, I should look at the color combo. It's called Herringback, Steve Farrar blend and Herringback. This is kind of the bluegill blue accent to that. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this and I'm going to V-style it right on top and try to get that 50-50. You can trim it if it's not perfectly even. And this is going to create one kind of an accent highlight color. And what it's also going to do is it's going to create a little thread bump right here so that when we pull this rabbit zonker over top of that, and then we trap down the excess wing fibers, we'll get a nice steep little crest to the rabbit zonker. And you'll see, it's going to help hold that kind of tall silhouette really nicely. Then you just wrap that back into that thread bump, and you can see how those are super flared. And that's going to help our steep dubbing head kind of blend into that and create that tall, sunfishy silhouette. Then I'm going to come on the bottom and finish up with my Steve Farrar blend. Pop this out of the vise, and all I'm going to do is I'm going to do the exact same thing I did on the back hook. I'm just going to roughen these fibers up so they kind of rest wherever they naturally want to rest. 45, 45, and then I'm just going to come over that middle line and blend that into that back cut. So I get a nice, clean belly. And again, you don't want to over trim it. If you know, when you think you're done, just kind of roughen it up. If you got some outliers, clean them up a little bit. But you don't got to be super, you know, the part of the silhouette just comes from cutting that Steve Farrar blend into quarters, which works perfectly for this kind of size range, and then tapering it just before you tie it in. So there's not a lot of trimming you got to do. It's all about, you know, material prep. Prepping those materials so that they're easiest to work with and they create the most natural silhouette on their own, so that you don't have to handle that with kind of, you know, the whole trimming process. So I'm coming in, I'm going to do laser dub on top and monster dub on the bottom. And that's solely just because I like the way the color combos worked out. and we're going to do a single head stack. And the way you want to do the head stack is important to get kind of that steep bluegill effect to it. I'm going to use quite a lot of fibers, and we're going to bind them down pretty aggressively. But I'm just going to orient these so I got some really good length to it, and you'll see it'll cover the entire front hook, but we're going to tie it in 70-30, but 30s, so I guess 30-70, 30 going back, so that we have this wing support to support this, so we have a really steep head, right? If you did it the other way around, you wouldn't get necessarily that really steep forward-leaning slope to the head. Like when I do a Jerk Junior, which is a two-stack head, I'll oftentimes do the first stack 70-30, 70 going back so that I get the length, and then I'll do a sparse 50-50 up front to build a little bulk into it. But when I'm trying to create a really steep head, especially on this, you know, when I'm doing imposters, when I'm doing kind of mega jerks occasionally, but that's like a three-stacker. I really like to do the 30 back, 70 forward, because it gets a really steep angle, which is beneficial obviously for the silhouette of this fly, but also if you're using like really large eyes and you need a base to put those eyes on, that's also important for that. Just making sure I got clean color separation. I'm using quite a bit of hook shank to bind that down because we have a lot of fibers kind of coming in. Separate and bring that through to the eye, and then we'll whip finish. And then to make this color combo happen, it's got quite a bit of post-processing going on. We're going to color this guy up with some chart pack markers, which are an alcohol-based kind of fly tying specific marker. You can see these guys. And those markers, they don't fade as easily. They stay permanent for a really long time. And the only trick to them is you really got to let them dry for about a day or so. But so I combed that out. Whenever I see, you know, dubbing heads, if you want them to look perfectly, first of all, when you stack this material, you should stack the material vertically, right? I put that only on top and only on bottom. This is going to be a little sub-tutorial on how to get kind of like the perfect epoxy head. So it's all stacked top and bottom. So right now, before you do anything, that should already be vertically displaced, right? That's already top and bottom just because I stacked it top and bottom. And I have just a little bit of sparse material on the sides so that I have a nice clean veil. Now, whenever you stack dubbing, there's always going to be trapped fibers, loose fibers, fibers that are kind of just in the way. Combing it out makes a huge difference into the viscosity. We're trying to get a tall, thin, profiled jerk head. If you have a whole bunch of loose, trapped fibers that aren't going to allow the water to pass over that material very easily, you're going to add water drag, right? And it's going to add bulk, and it's going to make pinching these eyes through the head to get the most durable head also more difficult, because you're going to have a thicker core. So that's why it's really important to orient the fibers before you stack them top and bottom, and then comb it out. You don't obviously need a comb, you can use a bodkin. This is just like 10 bodkins at once, you know what I mean? So we're coming in. We're going to hit this with a chart pack straight on top. And then I'm going to blend that with my finger. And make sure you use a different blending finger for the bottom, because that they'll blend, they'll kind of bleed into each other if you're not careful. I'm going to hit the mid belly of the throat with an orange. And then we're going to come in, we're going to hit the nose of the fly with a red, which is actually a Sharpie. But that's okay, because it's going to be covered with my epoxy stuff anyway. Now I'm going to come in. And small eyes seemed more appropriate for this pattern, so I'm going to come in with 7mm Flyman Living Eyes, and we're going to secure these with a product called Tear Mender in a Loon applicator bottle. And that's Tear Mender, and it's a really milky, kind of watery substance, and something that you can do is you really want to saturate close to the eye, and I like to get it on top and on bottom. And one of the reasons why is it'll kind of become tacky while you're working with it. I like to let it dry. I'll literally let this dry for like 10 or 15 minutes. And so while this is drying, like I have it top and bottom right now, it'll dry and hold that silhouette to the point where you don't necessarily need to use the UV if you don't have it. You know what I mean? It's so saturated through that dubbing that dubbing at the nose of that fly is gonna dry absolutely hard as a rock. And the only reason I do the UV work and the epoxy work is so that I can cover the sides and back of my eyes and just clean it up so that a tooth can't get behind an eye and pull it up off the dubbing. But it's all just a protective measure. The tear mender is what keeps it all kind of perfect. Where are these guys? And then you just take a pair of tweezers and you pinch that in place. So right now my dubbing head's not perfectly vertical, so I'm gonna hold these fibers, pinch these guys, and twist. And I'm just trying to reorient my dubbing stack underneath so that it's perfectly top and bottom. Then I'll just reapply those. And I'll just let that hang out. So these are, I got a whole bunch, I got like half a dozen sitting here that are already done, right? And these guys I did yesterday. And you can see that head has no UV work on it at all, but it's perfectly shaped. It's hard as a rock. It's 100% fishable right now. But I'm gonna come in with some Deer Creek UV Diamond Fine. I'm gonna coat those edges, and then I'm gonna give that head a little bit of barring just to match the faint barring of a bluegill. But that is the bare bones recipe for the Trout Nugget Jerk Junior Hybrid. I think I'm gonna call it the Con Man because that's a cool name, I suppose. But it's a really simple way to get kind of a short fly, bulky. That way you have a nice tall kind of sunfish silhouette head, but you have that movement of that tapered rabbit zonker tail fluttering in the back behind that with the push of water kind of over the shoulders. You have this shape sculpted belly that's going to be nice and firm and hold its silhouette. You have a joint, so you get a little bit of wiggle, but it's stiff enough that it's not going to foul. And you got a nice thick kind of lead hook, you know, a 4X thick hook that's going to keel a really tall bug like this. It's going to add a nice amount of mass to it so that when you're stripping it in, every time you give it slack, it's going to propel itself forward and deflect. And you need quite a bit of mass to overcome the friction from the trapped water of the SF belly. So that's the Con Man. Check it out. I guess I should probably take the pliers off. But thanks for watching. Hopefully you dig that pattern. I think it's a really sexy color combo. So sweet deal. Have a good day, guys.